church will stand, she will endure. He holds the keys of life, I look. Death has no sting, no final word. Fill this house with your glory. Fill this house with your glory. Let your presence fall upon us now. For all things are through you, and all things are to you. Render heaven, send your glory down. Fill this house with your glory. Fill this house with your glory. Let your presence fall upon us now. For all things are through you, and all things are to you. Render heaven, send your glory down.
Good morning. And a very warm welcome to the worship of God, to those here in church and those worshipping online. Do stay if you can after the service today for a cup of tea or coffee in the hall, time of fellowship together. There's some kind of noise in this microphone, isn't there? The service is next Sunday, 9:45 here in Teviot, 11:15 in St. Mary's, and 3 o'clock in Roberton. Yes. Just a reminder. Teviot and Roberton Kirk session. Just carry on, we'll see how we go on. Need to maybe get another microphone. I'll need to go over there maybe. Teviot and Roberton Kirk session, Tuesday evening, 7 o'clock, in the lounge here at Teviot. A prayer meeting, 7:30 on Thursday, as usual. If you want a link for that to join us, just ask me for that. And we've been hearing, of course, of the terrible earthquakes in Syria and Turkey. The Disasters Emergency Committee has opened its disaster appeal, and you can give specifically to the Turkey-Syria earthquake appeal through the DEC, Disasters Emergency Committee. You can do that at dec.org.uk there, and then you've got the follow the links through to the Turkey-Syria earthquake. You can also, I see from their website, donate to the earthquake appeal at the local post office, which might be useful for some of us. So as our call to worship today, we have a verse from Ephesians chapter 1, and let's say that together. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Amen. So let's sing to God's praise. All heaven declares the glory of the risen Lord. Let's start to sing. Worship you alone. Sarah's going to now lead us in prayer. Thank you, Sarah.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you are the one true and living God. You created this world and everything in it. You created us in your image, put breath in our lungs, and as the psalmist says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Father, we praise you. Lord, you are the expression of divine love and infinite compassion. You are goodness, gentleness, beauty, forgiveness, and mercy. Father, you have the words of eternal life and the power through your grace to save. We are in awe of who you are and everything you do. You are the light that shines in the darkness, the lamp on the lampstand, the house on the hilltop. Lord, we praise you for the great wonders you perform in our lives and in the lives of our families. No one else can do what you do. You are glorious in holiness, awesome in splendor, and your faithfulness endures forever. Forgive us, Lord, when we act in a selfish manner, when we put our own desires first without considering the needs of others or how these actions might make others feel. When we are filled with our own importance and fail to see the need in others. We ask, Father, that you soften our hearts so that we may show care, consideration, love, and compassion to our neighbors. Forgive us, Lord, when we are judgmental towards others and cause hurt or offense with our tongues and our opinions. When we are filled with pride and arrogance and believe our opinion is the only one that matters, that we are always right. Father, we pray that we may be led back to you, that you may strengthen us in our weakness and guide us along the path of righteousness, that we may follow the light of Jesus, showing kindness and unconditional love to others. Let us now take a moment and in the silence, bring before the Lord any sins we are carrying or behaviors we are not particularly proud of. Father, we ask that you bless the service as we are gathered here to worship you this morning through the hymns, Bible readings, prayers, and preaching. May your name be praised and glorified above all else. Let us now join our voices together and say the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Off, we'll try just this one, Phil. Mary's going to, can you hear me through that microphone? Let's just get this sorted before. Can you hear, is that being heard okay through that microphone? If I just speak normally like this, can you hear me? Good. Mary's going to come now and bring our Bible readings. Thank you, Mary.
I have looked it up. The reading this morning is from Leviticus chapter 14, verses 1 to 10. If you want to go with your Bible, it's at page 115. The Lord said to Moses, "These are the regulations for any diseased person at the time of their ceremonial cleansing. When they are brought to the priest is to go outside the camp and examine them. If they've been healed of their defiling skin disease, the priest shall order that two live, clean birds, some cedar wood, scarlet yarn, hyssop, be brought to the person to be cleansed. Then the priest shall order that one of the birds be killed over a fresh water in a clay pot. He is then to take the live bird and dip it together with the cedar wood, the scarlet yarn, and the hyssop into the blood of the bird that was killed over the fresh water. Seven times he shall sprinkle the one to be cleansed of the defiling disease, and then pronounce them clean. After that, he's to release the live bird in the open fields. The person to be cleansed must wash their clothes, shave off all their hair, and bathe with water. Then they will be ceremonially clean. After this, they may come into the camp, but must stay outside their tent for 7 days. On the seventh day, they must shave off all their hair. They must shave their head, their beard, their eyebrows, and the rest of their hair. They must wash their clothes and bathe themselves with water, and they will be clean. On the eighth day, they must bring two male lambs and one ewe lamb a year old, each without defect, along with 3/10 of an ephah of fine flour mixed with olive oil for grain, and offering one log of oil. Our second reading is from Matthew chapter 8, verses 1 to 4, and that's on page 972 in your Bible. When Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said, "be clean." Immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. Then Jesus said to him, "See that you don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them." Amen.
Thank you, Mary, for those readings. I'm going to sing now two songs together. I love you, Lord, and then How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds, the tune Rachel will stand to sing.
I love you, Lord. prayer. Let us pray. Lord, bless your word deep to our hearts now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We return today. I'm going to have to shout soon, I think. Put this one off and see what happens. Well, can you put it off at the back? Is there something else happening? We return today to Matthew's Gospel. A couple of years back, we had a fruitful journey, if you remember, through the Sermon on the Mount, which is found in Matthew chapter 5 to 7. And we pick things up again today at chapter 8. Matthew's Gospel is structured around five great blocks of teaching material from Jesus. And that mirrors the five books of the Pentateuch: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Moses' teaching. Here is the new Moses in Jesus. And the first of these teaching blocks is the Sermon on the Mount itself. The next block will come at chapter 10, when Jesus is sending the 12 disciples out on mission. And in between there, we have chapters 8 and 9 at this stage, which contains a huge number of miracles, three groups of miracles, each with three miracles in them. So the great teaching of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount is immediately followed by the great acts of Jesus in power and love in chapters 8 and 9. When he came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him, a man with leprosy came, and so on. That's in line with chapter 4, verse 23, where we get a wee summary verse that says, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in the synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. There you see it, the teaching and the healing, the words and the works of power. I think it's just great that we turn today to look directly at Jesus in his power and love. What better thing could there be to do but to fix our eyes on Jesus himself? In the midst of all the hard things, the dark things that are happening round about us, here at home and far away, Turkey and Syria and so on. Thanks be to God for his providence in bringing us to this word this morning, planned some time ago. So we turn to Matthew 8, verses 2 to 4, and it would be useful if you had your Bible there for this short passage, page 972 of the Pew Bible. Let me just read verses 2 to 4 again, because it's short. A man with leprosy came and knelt before Jesus and said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. I am willing, he said, be clean. Immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. Then Jesus said to him, see that you don't tell anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer the gift Moses commanded as a testimony to them. The word for leprosy in Greek was used for various diseases affecting the skin, as well as leprosy itself. But since we see this man coming earnestly to Jesus with his prayer, and as his healing heads the list of miracles in chapters 8 and 9, that would indicate that this was a serious condition that he had. A serious skin condition with no cure like leprosy. I obtained some information about leprosy from the internet. It's a bacterial infection which causes nerve damage, which, if left untreated, leads to a loss of feeling and crippling of hands and feet, paralysis and blindness. In very advanced cases, the person may have multiple injuries due to lack of sensation and can lose toes and fingers. There's been an effective cure since 1982, I understand, But it can't, however, of course, undo any disability that's already been caused by the disease. But back in Jesus' time, there was no cure for leprosy. It cut the sufferer off from society, made them live alone to avoid contagion. It was a kind of living death. Mary read from chapter 14 of Leviticus, chapters 13 and 14, speak about how these infectious skin diseases, leprosy and so on, were to be dealt with under the Jewish law. In chapter 13, if leprosy was discovered when a priest examined a person, then verses 45 and 46 of chapter 13 of Leviticus tell us what had to happen. Anyone with such a defiling disease must wear torn clothes, let their hair be unkempt, cover the lower part of their face, and cry out, "Unclean, unclean." As long as they have the disease, they remain unclean. They must live alone. They must live outside the camp. Well, there we have it, the effects of the illness itself on the person, of course, but also the social, spiritual isolation, the ceremonial defilement, the uncleanness under Jewish law. This one, does that remind you of anything? It struck me very much when I was preparing for this that the COVID regulations were quite similar, weren't they? Isolated in our homes, keeping our distance, 2 meters for a while, including even here in church, having to cover the lower part of our faces, the mask, touch forbidden, elderly relatives seen through a window. So we can identify to some extent with what these leprosy sufferers experienced their whole lives back in biblical times. It's really significant that the first person to come to Jesus for healing in these chapters is leprosy. Other diseases are healed. Now, this one alone is cleansed. We have that 3 times. It's not the word for cure or heal, it's the word for cleansed. We get our word catharsis from it. Cleansed. What above all else is wrong with us that makes us unclean before God? Our sin. Michael Green, referring to leprosy in the context of this passage, says this: "Never has there been a condition that so illustrated the spiritual condition of humankind. For sin is a terrible disease that separates us from our fellows and from God. It spreads and it is fatal." This man in his condition, in his isolation, in his uncleanness, comes to Jesus and kneels before him. The word kneel there is proskuneo in Greek, which means to bow down, kneel, but it also means to prostrate yourself before. It also means to worship. King James Version translates it as worship. He came and worshiped Jesus. He gives himself over before Jesus. He is serious in his engagement with Jesus. He is in earnest before Jesus. That word that means worship there means something like to come towards, to kiss. It's the kind of root of the word, proskuneo. What a beautiful picture of what we do when we worship the Lord, to come before, to come towards, to kiss. He comes earnestly to Jesus. Then comes his prayer of faith. We've got his prayer of faith. "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." What a prayer. He knows. He knows that Jesus has the power to make him clean, to transform his life radically, which is what would happen if that leprosy was taken away. What a change that would be for him. But he's not sure, is he, that Jesus wants to do that for him. "If you are willing, you can make me clean." The power's there, but is the willingness there? He's not sure, is he? There's a gospel song that says, "It is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he will do for you." Well, this man is saying what he's done for others, he might not want to do for me. Could that be you today? You know the power of Jesus is real in an objective sense. You don't doubt that. But somehow you can't quite see how it could be real for you in your own experience. Well, let's look at Jesus. That's what we want to do this morning, and see his response to this suffering man's prayer. First of all, there is his touch. His touch. How amazing this is. Think about it. Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. Mark's gospel says, filled with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. It speaks volumes, doesn't it? The touch. Think how we miss that physical contact through COVID. And then to be able to experience it again and what that meant. Night and day, really, day and night. Jesus broke through all the barriers, the risk of infection to himself and to others through him, the uncleanness, the disapproval of others. Why are you doing that? And he touched the man. This man deprived of human touch for so long, unclean, unclean, now felt the touch of God himself in the hands of his son. Isn't that lovely? The heart of Jesus expressed in his touch. The grace and compassion of God triumphs here over regulation. I'm just aware at the moment how regulated our society is, and that's necessary in many ways. But our society is so regulated. Jesus triumphs over regulation. For Jesus himself comes to fulfill the law in himself. He is Lord. He is God come as a man. He is the one who fully obeys God and always does what is right. He breaks through God's own law, if you like, because he has come to fulfill it and sort it out in himself. That's profound. The grace and compassion of God triumphs over isolation, disease, darkness, death, and sin. The untouchable one is touched by Jesus. How deep and wonderful is the love of Jesus. The Apostle Paul writes to the Christians at Rome, God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus doesn't just touch us, he died for us in the depth of his love for sinners. While we were still sinners, we didn't deserve it. He died for us. That was his touch. Now his willingness. See the definiteness of Jesus' response here. If you are willing, the man says. I am willing, says Jesus. You can make me clean. Be clean, says Jesus. There is this definiteness in the response of Jesus to those who call to him. All who call on the name of the Lord will be saved, says the prophet Joel, looking ahead to the days we are in, following the coming of Jesus and the giving of the Holy Spirit, the last days we are in. Peter quotes these words in his sermon on the day of Pentecost. All who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Paul quotes him in Romans 10 when he's speaking about people coming to faith in Jesus. All who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's definite. Or think of Jesus' promise in relation to our prayers. Everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks the door will be opened. There is definiteness here. There is a promise that will be kept. As we call on the Lord and come to Jesus in faith like this man did. Jesus says, there's no ifs or maybes. Jesus says to the man, I am willing. Be clean. It's a command. Be clean. A word that achieves what it says. And the man was instantly, immediately cleansed of his leprosy. When we come to Jesus, he will save and heal. He is willing to do that. He wants to do that. We need to know that, just as this man needed to know that. As we come to him, he will save us from our sin. Yes, he will. To quote Peter again, Acts 10 this time, all the prophets testify about him, that's Jesus the Messiah, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. And everyone means everyone who believes in him. As we come to Jesus in repentance and faith, he will for sure forgive and save us and give us eternal life through his death for our sins and his mighty resurrection. He brings us into the family of God. Nothing can ever separate us from his love. He works in us. He is working in us. He will work in us to make us more and more like Jesus until that day we are with him. We see him as he is. We are perfectly like him. That's for sure. But what about healing of physical and mental illness? Jesus here quite definitely healed this man of his physical condition, his leprosy. It was a miracle which speaks of his saving us from our sin, but also speaks of his power over all disease. Jesus still heals like that today. He can heal miraculously, instantaneously. He can also heal working through doctors and medical science. But even if neither of those happens, he will one day heal us of all that is wrong with us. Isaiah 53 says, by his stripes, speaking about the cross, by his stripes we are healed. Jesus' work in us through the cross is holistic. One day we will have perfect resurrection bodies, free from all imperfections, disease, injuries, disabilities, brokenness, wearing out, mental health problems, whatever it may be, we will be like Jesus with perfect resurrection bodies like his in the coming new heaven and earth. So we must not think if someone is not healed now immediately that there is not healing for them. It is promised. It will come as we trust in Jesus. Jesus is willing in respect of physical, mental healing too. If it's to be now as a miracle, he will make that clear as in faith we seek him in prayer, as others seek him in prayer. He will work by the power of his Holy Spirit to bring it about. If it is to be by natural means, if it is to be later, or if it needs to wait until heaven, he will give us the grace and strength and patience to cope with that and to live for him now until then. Be assured today of the willingness of Jesus to heal and to save us completely. He has the power to save completely, the book of Hebrews says. All those who come to him in faith. Jesus' touch, his willingness, now his power. His power. Jesus delivers this man from his leprosy. Just imagine what that would be like for him. We spoke about that. What would it be like for those looking on to see this man completely restored, made clean, healed? The condition was incurable, but Jesus cures him. He is the power of God himself at work. To have leprosy was to be dead while you live. Jesus gives life to the dead. With him, nothing is impossible. This is the one we're reading about here in God's Word. This is the one we're looking at today. He is the one we're here to worship. He's the one we're opening ourselves to as he comes to us by his Holy Spirit. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has power to save and heal. This miracle, along with all the others, and there's nine of them in this section, demonstrate who Jesus really is, the divine Son of God. God come as one of us. Second person of the Trinity. God as a man. In these days when the darkness surrounding us is deep, when there is so much that confuses us and perplexes us, when there is much that would push us as Christians back onto our back foot spiritually and feel that we're in danger of toppling over backwards and falling. Can you identify with what I'm saying? See here the power of Jesus. Hear it, receive it. Trust in him. Tell others about him. Live for him. Hold on to him. The great Anglican bishop, J.C. Ryle, says this: behold here a broad foundation for the faith of a Christian. We are told in the gospel to come to Jesus, to believe in Jesus, to live the life of faith in Jesus. We're encouraged to lean in him, to cast all our care in him, to repose all the weight of our souls in him. We may do so without fear, for he can bear all. He is a strong rock. He is Almighty God. His touch, his willingness, his power, and finally his fulfillment. Seems a strange wee bit at the end of this passage. Jesus gives the man, now healed, two instructions. First, don't tell anyone what's happened. It always seems odd to hear Jesus saying that. Don't tell anyone. See that you don't tell anyone. Surely Jesus would want people to know what he was doing. But we have this secrecy motif, as it's called in the Gospels here. Jesus had his own reasons for not wanting this man to say what was happening at this stage of his ministry. Perhaps he didn't want people flocking to him as some kind of special power-working man and misunderstanding who he was and what he'd come to do. But later in the Gospel, once he starts to teach about the cross and why he came, and he came to die, that it's a theology of suffering as well as of glory, and he came to die for our sins, things change, and there isn't this same reticence about speaking about what he's doing, same restraint. The other instruction is that the man has to go to the priest and make the offering, the sacrifices and so on that Moses commanded. And he's to do that as a testimony to them. And Mary read part of Leviticus 14 earlier for us, which Moses sets out what's to be done by the priest. When someone comes who's been healed of an infectious skin disease, what that priest is to do, and we heard about a live bird being dipped into the blood of a bird that had been killed, and then the blood being sprinkled on the cured man, and then lovely picture, the bird is set free in the open fields. What a lovely picture of cleansing, forgiveness, and freedom to fly in a new life. We heard about the person and his clothes being washed, all his hair shaved off, eyebrows, beard, hair. That's got practical and spiritual significance. And the rest of the chapter sets out various sacrifices and offerings, procedures to deal with sin. Jesus sends this man, cured of an incurable skin disease, leprosy, to the priest to make these relevant offerings as a testimony to them. Why was that? Because he wanted it to be known that he is the one who has fulfilled all of that. He is the one that these things pointed to, indeed cried out for. He wanted that to be known by the priest and by the whole system, religious system, if you like, I suppose, that here is the one that's come that fulfills Leviticus 13 and 14 and all that had to be done. He has cured and cleansed this man of his leprosy. So, says Jesus, go and carry out these sacrifices to show that I am the one who has fulfilled them all. Jesus is a fulfillment of the Old Testament. All it pointed forward to is a strong theme throughout Matthew. And we have it here right in this very first miracle of the nine in chapters 8 and 9. We don't need to look any further than Jesus. He is the one and only Savior and Lord. He alone is the fulfillment of all that the Old Testament scriptures point forward to. He alone, they were the shadow, he is the reality. He alone is the true fulfillment of all our deepest longings, desires, and aspirations. So we've seen Jesus at work here. We worship you, Lord Jesus, for your touch of compassion, for your willingness to save and heal, for your power, your almighty divine power, and for you being the fulfillment of everything that God promised in yourself. May God bless his word to our hearts. So we want to bless the name of the Lord now, and this hymn will also lead into the prayers that we'll have after that. Blessed be your name.
Still.
Before Sarah leads us in our prayers of thanksgiving, dedication, and intercession, we were shocked and saddened to hear during the week of the death and tragic circumstances of Catherine Schuller, wife of the Reverend Michael Schuller, and well-respected English teacher at the high school. We will remember in our prayers Michael and the family and all who grieve for Catherine.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God of love and wisdom, Lord, we are grateful that we can depend on you for guidance and direction when we face confusion and uncertainty in our lives. We know we can rely on you to carry us when our strength is running low, our hope is dwindling, or perhaps our faith is being challenged because of the circumstances that face us. You are the wonderful light that shines in the darkness. We are so truly thankful that in you, Lord, our souls may find rest, and for the strengthening power of the Holy Spirit at work in and through our lives. We thank you for our world and all that you provide for us, the changing of the seasons, the fragile flowers clothed with beauty, the fruits of the trees, for the birds of the sky. You shower us with an abundance of blessings. Lord, you are the source of all life, the God of all blessings, the giver of all grace. We thank you that your love surrounds us and fills us, and may we demonstrate love and compassion and patience towards each other in the same way you show your love to us. Heavenly Father, may we live in response to your goodness. Open our hearts to love and praise you, and inspire us always to live for your glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit. As well as dedicating ourselves to you, Lord, we also dedicate to you the offerings of money, so your kingdom may expand and to enable your work to be continued and grow throughout the church. Lord, we ask for your blessing on Megamix for tomorrow, and we pray that the children that come will draw closer to you. We hold before you Sheila and the team, and ask, Father, that you will work in them and equip them to carry out all that is needed to be done to nurture these children in becoming more connected to Christ, to hear your word in fun, creative ways that teach them more about the gospel message. Father, we pray for all those who have been affected by the catastrophic earthquakes in Turkey and Syria, for all those who have lost family members or friends amongst the thousands killed, for those who have lost their homes and all their possessions. Help them to see, Father, although they may have lost everything, that you are there. We pray for your comfort and peace upon them at this devastating time. We ask, Lord, that more people may be found alive, and that those injured will make a full recovery. May you walk beside them as they attempt to rebuild their shattered lives. Father, we hold before you the family of Catherine Schuller at this difficult and devastating time. Michael, their daughters, and the wider family. Lord, at a time of shock, mixed emotions, tragedy, and confusion, we ask that you hold them in your loving arms and that you will pour your balm into their hurt and pain. Lord, in their devastation and despair, may you guide them with your sovereign hand and grant them trust in the darkness and your deep grace. Enable them to see, Father, that no matter how deep the pit, the love you have for them is so much deeper. May you bless them with comfort, strength, and peace. May they be assured of your presence with them. We pray too for all those deeply affected, one way or another, by Catherine's tragic death. Comfort them, work in them by your grace and truth, and cause people to look to you in your saving power. Lord Jesus, you have the power to save, and through your grace, we too may be blessed with eternal life. Lord Jesus, you have overcome the world. You are the shining light of hope. We trust in you. Lord, we pray for the sick and the suffering. Especially today, we pray that you will be with Jane Bannerman and Sandy, with Jane's scan coming up this week. We pray for those who feel overwhelmed with sadness, consumed by depression or anxiety, or when every day is a bleak struggle to see any rays of light. We pray for those who feel trapped, when a dark shadow is cast over their lives and they can see no way out, no hope or path forward. We ask, Lord, that you hold them close, light up their path, and reassure them they are never alone on their journey. Lord, we hold before you all that are bereaved or grieving. For the family and friends of St. Mary's member, Dick Murray, who died on Tuesday at Douglas Head Court, and particularly his son, Richard. May you bless all who mourn, especially in their darkest moments, and bring comfort, strength, and peace upon them. We will now take a moment, and in the silence, bring before you, Lord, our own personal concerns. We pray, Father, in the face of all life's uncertainties, sorrows, hurts, disappointments, and failures, that the assurance of Christ's presence, power, and love may give us strength, faith, and hope. Lord, you hear all our prayers, spoken and unspoken. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn is Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Crown him with many crowns.
Lord Jesus, we give you thanks for who you are and all you've done for us. All other music shrinks away and fades away in the light of your heavenly music, the music of your glory. We worship you and thank you and ask that we will go now to love you, trust you, live for you. And now let's say the grace together. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
one at a time, and wrote the story of his love for everyone. He has filled our hearts with wonder, so that we always
I fix my eyes upon the cross, reaching out with all I've got. I'm letting go to start again. I need your love, that's why I'm here, waiting outside my life it calls. So while I'm here, I'll give my all. You are my peace within the storm. Here at the cross, I find my home. You are greater, Jesus, you are greater than it all. You are grace and mercy found me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is greater.